Coming up on this episode of DL Weekly, the last chance to get your ears on, Mickey moves into Hollywoodland.
Black Tap is open, the tech future of the parks, we talk to Chrysanthi and more. DL Weekly starts now.
Welcome to DL Weekly, a podcast about Walt's original Magic Kingdom, Disneyland. We cover the latest news and information from the resort, test our skills at trivia, and have a discussion about the parks every week. We invite you to send in your feedback and stories. Our contact information can be found at dlweekly.net. Now sit back, keep your hands and arms inside the podcast, and enjoy this week's show.
Hello, welcome to this episode of DL Weekly for the week of May 1st, 2019. I'm Teg Bushman.
And I'm Teresa Urban. We would like to send a shout out and a big thank you to all of our supporters on Patreon. This support helps to make DL Weekly possible. Our patrons get some pretty nice perks like access to our Discord chat, live shows, some DL Weekly swag, and more. If you would like to learn more, head on over to dlweekly.net/support.
Want a way to chat with us and the other listeners of the show about anything Disney parks related? You can head over to dlweekly.net/forum to be taken to our forums. The forums are free and open to everyone to chat about Disney parks all around the world. So head on over and make a quick post about yourself in the introductions forum and join in on the discussion.
Now let's get to the news.
Mickey's Mixed Magic is glowing away soon. Starting June 7th, Disneyland Forever, the fireworks and projection show from Disneyland's 60th anniversary, will be taking its place. Mickey's Mixed Magic proved to not have the staying power or guest enjoyment that was expected. Most nights, Mixed Magic played to limited crowds.
You know, I'm surprised by this. It seemed like it was a very short run for Mickey's Mixed Magic. But it is interesting to me that it sounds to me like they're taking into account the fact that they did have lower turnout for it. And so they're going to switch it up to something that the crowds are going to enjoy more. I do like that.
Yeah, I do too. I was surprised. I was actually kind of looking forward to this because it was such a different experience than a normal fireworks show for Disney, so or even a projection show. So the music was very contagious. So I wanted to see this myself. Unfortunately, when we're there in August, it's not going to be there. And Disneyland Forever, it was an okay fireworks show. I still wish they would have brought back Remember Dreams Come True. I think that is the most loved fireworks spectacular that they've ever had.
Well, our friends over at Concierge have let us know some details on what you will need to get reservations for Galaxy's Edge on May 2nd when the reservations open. You'll need a Disney ID, which can be set up on Disneyland.com. Make sure you have a few dates in mind in case your first selection isn't available. Once the reservation has been confirmed, it cannot be changed. Only one reservation can be made per email address, with the ability to add another 5 guests onto the reservation to enter the land. Disney still insists the best way to get a reservation is to book a Disney Resort hotel stay. As always, Mike, James, or Scott over at Concierge would be happy to assist with hotel reservations.
Yeah, again, there's not going to be any... There's no information at this point on what it's going to take to actually get one of these reservations. At 8 a.m. on May 2nd, Pacific time, they're going to post that information on Disneyland.com. At 10 a.m. is when everything's going to open for reservations, and I assume that everybody's going to be flooding to
Mad
try to get
dash.
That.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, like they said, make sure that you have your Disney ID, make sure you have an email address set up with them, make sure you know you've talked with your party, that you know the kind of dates you're going to go there. You know, if you're going to go for 3 or 4 days, pick some time frames in those 3 or 4 days, and hopefully you get it. Again, if you want to guarantee yourself a slot, you can do a Disney Resort hotel stay. And of course, like I said, like Teresa said, Mike, James, Scott, they can all take care of you over at Concierge. So they cannot make the reservation for you to get into Galaxy's Edge, but they can make the hotel reservation for you.
I think the thing to probably keep in mind is to just keep an open mind about it. And, you know, don't try not to get your heart set on this one specific time. You know, realize that it's you know, I'm not sure how many people that are going to be allowed in for each reservation. Depending on the day, there might be two, if not three blocks per day, for sure two. So I would assume morning slot, afternoon slot.
Right.
So just definitely just be open. I think really at this point, if you want to get in, be one of the first people to get in, you're just going to have to take what you can get, because I think it's going to be very hard to get exactly the perfect time slot. So my fingers are crossed for all of you guys out there.
Yeah. And I'm interested to see when this opens up in just a couple days. In fact, some of you listening to this episode, it might have already opened. But I'm interested to see like how quickly these slots like fill up.
And you're just out of luck. I think it's going to be like a blink or a snap.
So marvel of you. Well, the transplanted Mickey's PhilharMagic attraction from Magic Kingdom has opened in the Sunset Showcase Theater in Hollywoodland this week. The attraction lacks the wraparound screen from the original, but does utilize the screens on the side of the theater and Donald Duck in the rear of the auditorium. An updated exterior will be installed in the coming months to make the attraction more permanent. I was excited to see that.
I'm curious about this because I kind of thought that this was going to just be a temporary thing to put into that theater. But if they're going to be updating the exterior, definitely is going to be around for a little while. So
At least they're going to update it to something. I don't know if it'll be like, I wonder if they're just going to make it more theater like, almost like the Hyperion.
Sure.
Where then they could put something else in, but it looks more permanent. Because right now, I think Hollywoodland is going to start moving away from, you know, the backlot studio feel.
The kind of like warehouse look.
Yeah, to go more with something that would fit in with Marvel Land, which is what's been rumored to kind of expand over into that area. So, you know, if you have something, you know, like the Hyperion or the Sunset Showcase Theater, you can make it look like a real theater and then it's just part of your cityscape for Marvel. That's
true. Very true. Well, after quite a delay in opening, Black Tap Craft Burgers and Beers opened this past Saturday. The downtown Disney location is the only Black Tap to have the Strawberry Shortcake Crazy Shake. It's a strawberry shake with a vanilla frosted rim with crumbled cake, a strawberry shortcake ice cream bar, pink twisty lollipop, whipped cream, strawberry drizzle, and a cherry on top. You can watch your shake be made through the window to the kitchen or get a shake to go.
Yeah, apparently that's something that they don't do at any other location. You can't see into the kitchen at the other locations, and they don't have to-go shakes. But these shakes, much like...
They're works of art.
Yeah, I don't remember what it was before, but these things are definitely something that's more a spectacle to look at than to like want to really eat.
Probably a spectacle to watch to be created, too, and to be put together. That's a lot going on with that strawberry shortcake. Crazy shake. I like how it's called a crazy shake, not just a shake.
Right. Yep. That's what their shakes are kind of about. So that's what they're known for. I'm interested to see these. I don't know for me if I want to. I mean, they're pretty large too.
We'll share one when we go.
We'll share one with our whole group when we go, I think. Well, if you are an annual pass holder, you can purchase a tumbler for $14.99 that allows refillable beverages on the date of purchase. You need to keep the receipt and have your physical annual pass available to get the refills. The promotion is good through May 21st. So in the next, you know, 3 weeks or so, this is going to be available. I don't know if, I mean, it's cool because you get the tumbler for $14.99, but then, and you get refills that day. I think it'd be more exciting to me if you could buy the tumbler and get refills through that whole period.
Kind of like the popcorn buckets that they sometimes do for AP holders. You buy the special popcorn bucket and then you get like refills you get discounted refills for a certain period of time. I think I'd be more excited about this if it was extended for more than just the date. And even if they did like the popcorn buckets, just at a much smaller price point for your refills.
I'd do a dollar refill because, you know, I mean, because a soda at Disney is like three something, right?
So yeah, so that's still a better deal.
Yeah, and definitely. You get the tumbler out of it, and that's a souvenir.
Plus, you're being green.
That's true.
Well, in a pretty expected move, Disney announced this week that PhotoPass will be a part of Galaxy's Edge when it opens later this month. That is so crazy to me. I just have to pause right now. I did not think we'd ever get to the point in time where we would say Galaxy's Edge opens later this month. It has seemed so far out in the future to me. I don't know what is going to happen when we make the announcement that it has officially opened. My mind might explode at that point.
It's going to be a busy a busy week for us because I feel like there's going to be so much, so many details that people are going to talk about. And of course, I know for a fact that we have people in our audience that they're over Star Wars everything. So
that's okay.
Those episodes we'll have to clearly mark and people will just skip that episode.
Well, I'll continue on with our news story. But as we reported before, Fast Pass and Max Pass will not be offered in Galaxy's Edge initially. So that is exciting that PhotoPass will be there. I don't know how PhotoPass couldn't be a part of that land. It looks like it's going to be beautiful.
I am really interested to see how they theme the PhotoPass people, because obviously everything's going to be themed, so your PhotoPass photographers are probably not going to look like PhotoPass photographers.
Right.
So I'm wondering if, like, even their cameras are going to be, like, disguised as, like, Star Wars stuff. You know what I mean? Like because they want it to be so immersive. They're going to hold up, like,
a droid or something to take your droid. Yeah, they're going to, I don't know. Just an idea.
There you go. That'd be very cool. I like this idea. I'm excited now. If you have, like, a little R2, like, taking your picture, that'd be awesome. Well, the Orange County Register asked the question this week, what does the digital future of Disneyland look like? A lot of the tech that could be coming to the Play Disney Parks and Disneyland mobile apps is already available in Florida with the use of Magic Bands. Mm-hmm. Interactive experiences, mobile payments, and directions to merchandise could be coming to the apps in the future.
It's really surprising to me that we don't have the Magic Bands yet. I really thought that it was going to be piloted out at Walt Disney World and then eventually would come back to Disneyland. So it's,
and all the other parks.
Yeah. So it's surprising to me that they haven't done that before, because it seems like it's a great, I mean, very convenient, obviously. Yeah. But the cool thing about it is it builds excitement, because you can get the magic passes, or excuse me, the magic bands in the mail weeks before your trip. Yep. Plus they have all those different skins for them, so you can customize them.
Well, I look at it like, it just seems like a, you know, I know this sounds terrible, but it's a great money-making opportunity, because, like, if I go to the park, I have a magic band upstairs. It's just a plain purple one or whatever that I got. But they have so many cool designs. They just came out with an Avengers one that looked really cool.
Yeah, they've got very cool designs.
And so I feel like it's almost on the level of pin trading, where, like, people will collect these different magic bands. And the fact that, like, if I could just wear a magic band and not have to bring my wallet and all that stuff.
Correct, yeah.
And if I was staying on property even, like, it's your door key, it pays for your stuff, it's your fast passes, it's your everything. So I don't know why they haven't brought this over. But I am excited that more functionality is coming to these apps. The only concern I have is if you how much are they going to shove into one app? Is it going to bog things down? Is it going to be really large? And is it going to eat your battery and data?
And my concern is the last time that I was there and I used the app, the Wi-Fi there was not very great. So it did use data, whatever. I'm not very techie. It used the data from my phone instead, which really drained down my battery. So it would have been nice if I could have always had decent connectivity with the Wi-Fi. But so hopefully with how much they're going to be offering and how much they're expecting people to use these apps, they will get better Wi-Fi. So people's, I mean, it's still going to drain your battery, but hopefully not as
well. Hopefully in Galaxy's Edge, they've thought about this and have put wireless access points like everywhere.
Yeah, I really hope so. D23 3-day tickets have sold out. So if you want to attend the expo this year, you will have to buy individual day tickets going forward. There are still single day tickets available for all 3 days, so you have not missed out yet. It's just going to be a little bit more expensive.
Yep, I was not surprised. Actually, if anything, I was surprised that it took this long for 3-day tickets to sell out.
That's what I was going to say. We bought ours like the day they became available because we were worried that they would sell out quickly. So apparently, we were not on the correct thought process for that, but they have sold out now.
Well, now I'm eagerly awaiting the next thing, which is when they're going to announce all of the events that you can sign up for or that are going to be available, because we don't really know anything about that yet.
The countdown is on.
Yeah, it's going to be very exciting. Speaking of a countdown, if you go to our website, there is now a countdown to D23 and our trip to Disneyland on the side. So for anybody who wants to know how long until D23, you can go on there and get a good countdown. If you want to know when we're going to be in the parks, there's a countdown there for that, too. Well, just a reminder that as of May 1st, which is the day this episode's going live, the new stroller, ice, and smoking rules are in effect. Strollers will be measured against signs that have been installed on the ground to ensure compliance. No more loose ice or smoking in the parks is allowed either. So I like this. They have this cool little, kind of like when you go to the airport and, you know, they've got those like bins and they said, like, if your suitcase doesn't fit, then you got to check it. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like that, but it's just on the ground.
Yeah, it's kind of like a footprint, I guess, would be a good way of explaining. It's a sticker on the ground that you can park your stroller over. And so you will visually be able to see if it's over. So you don't have to get your tape measures out or anything like that. So it'd be a good visual thing. The only thing that I'm slightly worried about is this is right at the front, you know, right at the front gate. So right before you get through the security check is where it seems to be, is just the difficulty if your stroller does fall outside of that box, you know, kind of then what. But I'm sure, I hope that Disney has a plan in place for that. I do think we had reported that they are going to have a space that you can put your stroller so that you wouldn't have your, if your stroller is too large, there's a place that you'd be able to store your stroller for the day so you wouldn't have to take it all the way back to your hotel. They did mention that. So I do like that they are trying to help and trying to accommodate and make it a little smoother, I guess.
Well, that's a lot better than what they've done in the past. So like before, you know, when the selfie stick ban came in, if you had a selfie stick, you could give it to security and they were going to throw it away.
Exactly.
Or you could take it back to your car. Mm-hmm. That was your only option. Obviously, Disney's not going to make you throw away your stroller or sacrifice your stroller. So they definitely have to have something set up. Although, can you imagine, let's just say, you know, let's say 1 in 100 people that bring strollers have one of these. I mean, that's going to take up a lot of space.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure they're working it out.
Well, before we take our trip over to Trivia Land, where producer James is going to try and stump us with some Disney trivia, we wanted to take a minute and invite our new guest and welcome her onto our show. Please welcome Chrysanthi. She's a violinist, songwriter, and AP holder to our favorite place on Earth, Disneyland. So welcome, Chrysanthi.
I'm super happy to be here.
Well, we're happy to have you.
Are you ready for some trivia questions with us?
I'm terrible at these, but I want to play anyway.
That's okay. We're not great either.
There's no better way to start.
Well, James is going to read us the question. We're going to all attempt to answer them. And then James is going to give us the correct answers after the discussion topic. So what do you have for us this week, James?
Well, I pulled the first question from the Disney Play app, so it's not my fault. What state did the petrified tree come from?
Ooh.
California?
I'm going to say Arizona.
Washington.
I feel like that was random. I liked it.
Yeah. Well, usually we sit and discuss for so long and we all just kind of threw out an answer and we're like, moving on.
This one you can't really talk your way out of. It's just got to be instinct. You know it or you don't. So, all right, our second question. I have a little more faith in you on this one. When did the Nightmare Before Christmas holiday overlay start at the Haunted Mansion? And I will accept just a year is acceptable.
Oh my gosh. I've heard you talk about it on the podcast.
2001.
I was gonna say 2000 or 2001. Should I be swayed by Tag?
Whichever way you want.
Oh wait, would it have happened pre-9/11 or post? I'm just gonna say 2000.
I'm gonna be different. I'm gonna say 1998.
All right, our third question, which comes from listener Eric J. What is the name of the mining town location in which Big Thunder resides?
Like fictionally, you mean?
Oh.
Yes.
Oh my God.
I'm going to say Rainbow Ridge.
Yeah, I was going to say Rainbow Ridge also.
Why was I going to say Rainbow Cavern? Wait, oh, that's something else.
You're on the right track, though, because Rainbow Caverns used to be an attraction that was there.
Yeah, right. Yeah. You know, I'm going to Rainbow Ridge it up.
That either is a great sign or a terrible sign. Yeah.
We're either all on the correct mind train or the wrong one.
Oh,
wow. That was good.
I don't know if that'd be good. I know it's up your alley of level of humor, James.
Absolutely. All right, our last question. Couldn't have a week without a numbers question. This one comes courtesy of Katie J. Star Tours can be a different experience every time you ride it. How many different ride variations does it have?
A lot.
But not anymore.
Uh-oh, but not anymore.
Right? I feel like in the last few months, they switched it to just be one specific track to end at Galaxy's Edge.
Oh, yeah, they probably have.
That makes sense, yeah.
Because I've gotten lots of repeats. Let me just tell you.
Of the whole thing or just ending at Galaxy's Edge?
Pretty sure the whole thing. Like you go to like Crate and you go to like I'm pretty sure it's, you know, just new Disney property stuff.
Oh.
That makes sense.
Which makes me sad. But
it used to be
okay,
a lot.
Prior to that, I would say, oh my God, it's either, let me think, Factorials. Let me think.
That high school math to youths.
I love numbers, but not trivia numbers. I don't know. It's either 164 or like 64. I'm going to say 64.
I was
180.
Way higher.
Yeah.
180?
180. That's my random number.
I'm probably way, way wrong, but I'm going to say like 1,200.
I also want to note that I really do want to find out the answer to this and know if it's just a matter of like, if there are eight options, and so like 8 times 8, or if it's more like there's 8 options, but options 1, 2, and 3 can only be slotted in position number 1. You know what I mean?
I got the answer for you. Don't worry.
Okay. Awesome.
She's really excited.
I'm excited. I want to know how.
I'm also wondering, does the vehicle move differently versus like when you're watching the same screen, I guess would be a good way of saying it.
Yeah.
Like
the vehicle's programmed to go with the video.
So can you watch the same video but have a different ride experience?
I don't think so. They program it the one way with that video.
I don't think
they just stitch the video together differently. Every time you go hyperspacey, it goes to a different place. Except for now, apparently.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, great questions there. We'll look forward to hearing the answers after a little bit more discussion with Chrysanthi.
Well, this week for our discussion topic, we actually have a special guest on that we've already kind of talked a little bit about. Chrysanthi is joining us to talk about probably like normal when we have a guest on, probably a number of things. But I think the main thing that we're going to talk about tonight is being an adult in Disneyland with autism and kind of how that experience kind of goes and some experiences that Chrysanthi's had. And yeah, so it could be some tips and tricks that other people might find useful as well in the park. So I will say to start off the conversation, we're going to get to the questions, but I kind of want to lead into why we're having you on the show. So first of all, welcome to the discussion topic portion.
Thank you.
What made me want to have you on the show, and I think Teresa saw this too, was you actually had a nice discussion on Twitter about an experience you had recently in the parks. Did you kind of want to talk about that just a little bit to give our listeners an idea of kind of an experience you had?
Yeah, I went to the park last weekend, actually. And, you know, I didn't really see it coming, but it ended up with me having a shutdown in one of the stores. And it was the store that is attached to Star Tours. And this is like a common thing that happens with autistic people is like meltdowns and shutdowns and things like that. Usually they're associated with children. And you kind of wonder like what led up to it. And I was describing in the Twitter thread how throughout the day, there were a series of just tiny minuscule things that maybe in isolation weren't that big of a deal. But once they added up, it suddenly just like exploded and like caused a really bad physical reaction and just like basically shut down. I was like sitting underneath hangers of clothing, just like everyone was like trying on stuff around me. It was super awkward and weird. And something that happened in the park was a lot of cast members that day were giving me sort of a weird suspicion I detected. Where, you know, it seems, because I'm able-bodied, just to give listeners a picture, I don't use a wheelchair. If you just talk to me or see me, like when I'm having a good day or a good minute, like you would not necessarily think, oh, autistic, until I say it. And so I know that since there's a lot of abuse of the disability access services, that people who maybe are not in wheelchairs or maybe have what's called an invisible disability, like autism, can be met with side eye at times, sort of like having to prove it or like, you know, being told, oh, that's, you can't use that. That's not for you. Like, why do you have that? Disney's usually really good about not doing that, but there still are times where it does happen. So that was just one of those days where, you know, I kept having to be like, I have the disability access service, or, you know, I asked for something and I was like, that's only for disabled visitors. And I was like, so you know how it's just really vulnerable to have to like put yourself out there every time once you've already gotten the pass and like there's people around you also looking at you funny. And then like it kind of embarrasses you when you're in front of your party. And when you're an autistic adult, like I am, it's not like your parents are just going to speak up for you. It's like, I'm with my friends, or like I'm with my, or, you know, I don't want this to be a big deal. I don't want to make it a big deal. Like I'm, the reason I'm getting the service or asking for special accommodations is so that I don't like hinder the rest of my party and so that I can kind of have more of a normal experience. So anyway, I had a meltdown at the Star Trader.
So the way that the cast members kind of side-eyed you throughout the day, that kind of added to you ending up in this kind of episode?
Yeah. And I want to be clear, it wasn't just that. And
sure.
Disney cast members are by and large amazing, but those things kind of added on to a multitude of things. So another thing that was happening at that time, it was just a fortuitous blend of events, was there was Mickey's celebration stuff going on. There's been a lot of like really loud kind of club style music going on in the park this year. Not just with the nighttime show, which is very overwhelming, like with DJ Mickey and stuff.
Oh, sure. Right. Yeah.
But also just at that stage, you know, at that Tomorrowland stage during the day, there was that music happening. And then like the music in the start, like just the way that the musics were blending in that spot that I was in was just like, suddenly it just became too much. Just suddenly it was fine. And then it was not fine at all. And then at the same, when it was not fine, it was also just like all these other things were shutting down. I was just like, my breathing, my, you know, like, do I need, I don't even know. Do I need water? Do I need this? I need to sit down. Like, I'm just going to faint right here. You know, I was with my mom. She was like, oh, you should try on this jacket. I'm like, I just kind of stopped talking. I just kind of went nonverbal. And my mom could kind of tell, she's like, what's wrong? And you know, she just kind of waited outside for me for like 20 minutes while I just sat there. Like on the floor in the middle of the store. So, I like to prevent stuff like that happening by just making sure that I just remain comfortable during the day.
Totally understand.
And I realize.
My heart. That just breaks my heart, you know, and like you said, being an adult, I can understand how that it would be much more difficult, whereas like a child, the parent could scoop them up and take them somewhere else, whereas you just kind of have to deal with it in that moment where you are, you know.
Well, not only do you have to deal with the situation that's happening, but you also have to defend yourself against people. So unlike when generally I would guess when you're a child, like your parents can shield you from that and deal with that, and they're not having to also deal with it. Mm-hmm. And so when you're older, you're on your own.
Yeah.
And no, so it makes it even
and you
more
want
struggle.
To be on your own.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
You don't want to have to need your parents all the time. Like I'm a pretty independent adult. Like not a lot of autistic people, like there's so many different ways to be autistic. Mm-hmm. It's really a spectrum for that reason. And like, you know, I can drive, which not every autistic person has the same level of independence in specific areas of life. So like someone might be higher in one thing and like lower in another or whatever. So, I mean, I'm lucky that, I can go to Disneyland by myself and I know the park well, and I'm like, I can be independent in that regard. But another thing that kids have, is that their parents can also prepare for the trip for them and hold whatever they need. You know, if they need any aids, like I have to go to the park with like my noise canceling headphones. And so it's just one more thing for me to carry and just ask for myself for like various things I need and just prepare and take care of parking and go through the driving and the traffic and the coordinating. And if I'm meeting up with people, getting my passes. So it's just, you just have more on your plate. Anyone would understand that just when you are the one organizing a trip, for example, or, then you're probably going to be a lot more burned out than someone who's just along for the ride being taken care of.
Right.
And when you're autistic, really that's just magnified because every the trip to the grocery store sometimes takes the level of planning that like an overseas trip would take for someone else.
It's a great way to kind of explain it and to kind of, you know, relate it back. So, you know, I don't know. I guess a good way for like Tag and I, who are not autistic, to kind of get a better sense of, you know, how overwhelmed you can feel and, you know, kind of more a sense of what that means for you. So when you go to the parks normally, is there, you know, you go, how many times did you say that you had gone this year already? Didn't you say that you had gone like,
I mean, this year I've gone like 5 times.
Yeah, like 5 times already this year. So you go frequently. So are there kind of some things that you try to always do that kind of helps you through your day when you're in the parks?
Definitely. Well, I always like make sure that I'm registered for the Disability Access Service, mm-hmm. which lasts for 60 days when you're a pass holder. So then you have to keep renewing it. I also make sure that I am dressed really comfortably and have enough like warm layers potentially, because it can get cold at night. Mm-hmm. I also like to have an idea of what my time frame is, because, and like, here's another thing about being autistic is you don't always have the stamina to be there for a full day. It's like, it's actually funny to me when people even talk about going for a 3-day trip or whatever. That's like inconceivable to me to do a 3-day.
Let alone me, who's like, I will not go for less than 5.
You're right. Yeah.
Yeah. Inconceivable.
I love that word. It makes me think of the Princess Bride.
I mean, my brother went to Disney World time last year, and oh gosh, I believe he and his girlfriend had like 10 days in a row. I was like, what?
Oh my gosh.
What? Like full days.
I would
like,
do 10. I would do 10 days.
Like full on.
I would be a puddle. I would be a puddle of a person. No way.
Yeah. No, I've left as early as like 2 p.m. before. Going right at the beginning. Now I can do full day sometimes. While depends on all the conditions, all the things that lead up to it, and you know, and whatever. But other things that I like to do are make sure that I'm eating at whatever, you know, make sure I don't have any food or water needs. Like I have specific things that I bring. I bring 2 water bottles. I bring my noise canceling headphones. I wear my Crocs just in case I go on Splash Mountain, because wet socks and shoes are like a big issue. Not okay to feel those. To feel,
you know, I feel like Crocs were probably designed for Splash Mountain. I think you're onto something here.
They really are. They're
cool. Comfortable to walk around in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Another thing, my brother, when he went to Disney World for 10 days, they wore Crocs every day and said it was absolutely essential, especially with the rain and like going in and like your sweat so off.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah,
I might have to pick up a pair of Crocs before we go on our next trip.
Yeah, I'll send you a link to mine. They actually don't, they don't look like normal Crocs.
Ooh, perfect.
That's like what I just bought for work. I bought a pair of Crocs that look like dress shoes, because I wanted something that was gonna be light and comfortable, and I was like, well, I'll try it. And I hate the look of regular standard stereotypical Crocs.
Another thing that I always do is I bring very specific things. Like I bring a gallon size plastic bag for like food items that I can't finish all at once, so that I can carry them throughout the day in my own bag.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, I have a whole list. I have a list on my computer. That's my Disneyland packing list every time.
So does your list of things, does it fit into like a backpack, or how do you carry all this stuff around? Okay.
Yeah. I carry a backpack.
When you have to register for the special assistance pass, what do they require of you when you go in there? Because obviously if somebody shows up in a wheelchair or something, it's like, oh, okay, yes. Or, oh, you have a cast, yes. What do they require of somebody who with autism that requests one of these passes?
You state your disability, and then they ask this is just with me. They always ask me, what specifically do you have trouble with? So then I have to graphically detail what is hard for me about the park.
Yeah.
Every 60 days. This is actually one of the most annoying things. Like, can't I just like have it on my record? Do I have to go through this every day, every time?
Because you would think they would keep a record of talking to you. And if they're like, oh, for the last 3 years, every 60 days you've gotten one of these, we should just save everybody some time and just... Mm-hmm. Give it to you.
Well, yeah, especially for pass holders. If you have to keep, if you have to keep renewing, then yeah.
And on one hand, it's against the law to ask for proof. Mm. And, you know, and it should really be, because there's a lot of access concerns with requiring proof.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. But at the same time, sometimes I'm just like, please, here are my diagnosis papers. I don't want to talk about it. Like, can you just read the statement? Like, I don't want to go through it. You know? So yeah, the irony is they're not allowed to actually look at the papers, but I would rather, for me, I would kind of almost, it would be easier for me if they just did it and I didn't have to
can,
like.
Can I just sign a waiver so you can read this stupid paper and be done with it?
Yeah, that maybe.
Yeah, just go in and be like, do you have a waiver or something that like I can sign away? Like you, I give you permission to read this medical paper and then just read it because like I don't want to have to explain it to you each time. I don't know. It does seem, I can see it from both sides. I can see it as, you know, they're trying to, if they make it a pain like this, people that are doing it just to do it are less likely to do it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You mean the people that don't actually
that don't need it.
Pass.
Yep. The people that are abusing the system. Mm-hmm. But then unfortunately, like with all things in life, that also means that the people that need it are inconvenienced even more.
Yeah.
I think though, I think you always have to err on the side of someone, even if you really suspect it's just, I mean, even liability wise, you just have to believe someone and you should. Cause I mean, like I said, like, at the very beginning of the day when I've just entered the park, like I'm at my best. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to look like I'm suffering at that time.
And that's the time that you're having the conversation with them trying to explain it. So, yeah.
Yes. And then, you know, performing your disability is really messed up. And like, it's messed up to have to do it, to have to like perform it and be like, okay, wait, you know? So I don't like doing that. I don't want to do, like, I'm not into that. So I don't want to do that.
Right.
It's too bad. I feel like Tag said, I get both sides of it, but yeah, you're right. It's too bad that you don't have to kind of sit there and awkwardly have to explain all that and go through that. And I could see how that could cause a problem for some people to kind of be put on the spot like that and have to.
Well, just think about people that go through trauma, any type of trauma, point, right? But, let's just say, you know, not that autism is, you know, a trauma necessarily, but you know, people that go through something, for instance, my mom has some medical issues. Every time she goes to the doctor, she has to like go through all of her steps again. And I'm like, don't you guys have a computer system that you put all this stuff in? Like, couldn't the doctor just review this? Mm-hmm. Like, that's the thing that annoys her the most is she's like, every time I go to the doctor, I gotta go, I take this medication and I talk to Dr. So-and-so about this and Dr. So-and-so about that. So it's, I could see what you're saying, Chrysanthi, which is, you know, when you go, you have to like explain every single time. You're like, I have, you know, this type of autism and it manifests itself like this. And I look fine right now, but you know, you know, 4 hours from now when I'm under a closed rack in the Star Trader.
You're going to wish that you just gave me the.
Yeah.
You're actually bringing up a good point. Also, it sucks that your mom has to go through that.
Right.
And it's one of the hardest parts to explain about autism because everyone, I think a lot of people are aware of the fact that autistic people have unique sensory needs just because we're very hypersensitive to things. You know, sound.
That's probably the most well-known thing, I think, about autistic folks.
But a really, really big one that is much harder to talk about is cognitive needs. And what you're describing is an example of adding something to a cognitive load. So cognitive needs, I mean things like, you know, it encompasses skills like attention, memory, executive functioning, decision making, and even just awareness, like knowing how far someone is, like navigating and just little things like that. All of these things can be very taxing and hard to describe why they're taxing.
Well, I mean, Teresa, I don't think Teresa has autism, but she talks constantly on the show about how when she goes to Disneyland, you know, she's distracted by everything. I mean, it's taxing on someone, you know, it's taxing on the general person, I guess, you know. Yeah. So imagine, you know, having even a slight issue, you know, with any of that, it's just going to get even that much more difficult.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Almost like everything magnified.
With many autistic people, every step of the way is like a complex chain of micro steps. So something as simple as like getting a drink of water is not just a simple act. It's where am I going to get it? Where's my wallet? How do I, like, is my jacket in a comfortable enough position where I can reach for it? Should I ask someone in my party to grab it for me? Or, you know, is it going to be awkward and will I be you know, messing something up. Am I actually thirsty or not? Oh, but wait, if I drink water, then I'm going to have to use the restroom more and we're about to go on this. So that wouldn't be a good time. Oh, maybe I should do it after this. Or, you know, I'll just, and then when getting it, it's like, all right, remember to smile, remember to talk slowly, remember to this and that. So it's like everything just takes a lot more work. It's not that I can't do it. It's just little things are not necessarily little things. Sometimes
I'll tell you, if I had to think about all of those things when I did anything in life, I would be very frustrated. Yeah. So I can totally understand the cognitive, exhaustion that you get just from, because people don't understand, they don't understand that there's that many steps going on internally, because obviously, again, it's not something you can see. If you see someone with crutches, you can see that it's a struggle for them to get up a flight of stairs. If somebody is having a struggle deciding whether they can get a drink of water or not, that's not something you can easily understand. It's not in front of your face. It's not something that makes sense to you if you haven't experienced it or been explained it, which is hopefully what listeners are getting from us about it.
Yeah. And if anything, it just will look like they're being really quiet or will look like something's bothering them and you're not really sure what it is. And then it can lead and social things are another struggle for autistic people. And then it can look like, they look uncomfortable for some reason. Not someone who without autism might think, oh, did I say something? Oh, they're upset. Oh. So now I'm going to start So then, they'll be like, why are you in a bad mood? And then it just turns into sort of a fight. And it sort of just stems from I'm not having my personal needs met. And it's looking like I'm pissed off and I'm really not. And now it's starting a fight and now it's starting a thing. And it just
makes it worse.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
So we've talked about this a lot on the show. And I think you're uniquely capable to be able to kind of maybe give some suggestions for this. We had a discussion a few months ago about the fact that, some people were upset with the access pass and stuff, which we've already talked about. But do you think that do you have any suggestions on a way that Disney could make Disneyland more, more accessible to folks with autism? I know we talked about some of the suggestions we came up with in our discussion was maybe you have, an evening time or something, or even a whole day, twice a year or something where, music is turned down and, you have, the parades and stuff. You still have all the entertainment, but maybe you just kind of dull it down a little bit so it's not so jarring to people that, that's sensory overload for them.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I remember that episode well, because I almost commented on it, but then I was like, well, the cognitive load kind of just got too much. And I was just sure. Oh my gosh, there's so many things. I don't know how to say them. I have so much to say. Oh, but now here I'm on the podcast. So I'll say them. I think a couple things. One, that it would be generally a good move to have, a couple themed days per year where what you said, I think that would be lovely, but I would be really upset if that were the only thing they were doing. And, I think what needs to happen is, and I have so many suggestions, is building in more of a permanent framework for having this kind of an everyday, more in an everyday situation. Because of other kinds of accessibility concerns, not all autistic people are going to be able to go on those same days.
Right.
And also the fact that I'm an adult and I want to go by myself and with my friends. I don't want to go on a day for autistic people. You know what I mean? I probably wouldn't go on that day except to just show solidarity. And another thing is, this is one of the biggest ironies with autism is conflicting access needs are a huge thing. So autistic people will have needs that are on vastly different ends of the spectrum. So one person might really, really need things to be really super cold. Another person might need things to be super hot. One person might crave a certain noise and another person might absolutely detest it. When it comes to actually those sensory friendly movie theater experiences that I've heard of, where they allow, you know, people to talk during, like, move and talk during it, like, and the music is down and the lights are up a little bit. I wouldn't be able to go to those. That would trigger me too much.
So it's good for some people that need thing, but not obviously for everybody. Cause like for you, it would be very upsetting.
Yeah. Cause we feel things on sensory extremes, both ends of the spectrum, either hypersensitivity or hyposensitivity, like needing, craving, like really craving those things. Like I, for example, really like super deep pressure. And that's why a lot of autistic people also like weighted blankets and being swaddled or just like being really tightly like wrapped up. And other people are just like, don't put anything near me. I can't have anything touching me.
Right.
So I could see how that, that could obviously not work very well if you're trying to be Disneyland and you're trying to do things to kind of be welcoming to everyone. You could be only
making it worse.
Yeah, you could be making it worse for some. So that's that.
But I think what would be cool is if there were like one or two shows per day that were sound and like, you know, reduce sensory whatever, you know. So why not make one of the six shows a sensory friendly one every day?
And I feel like that wouldn't be hard for them to do. No, you know, you just program it in and, you know, like Mickey and the Magical Map, right? You just, the third show of the day or whatever, you switch to the lower program or whatever.
Other program is, exactly. The other thing I was thinking too is, so we were talking about just the overall music and the sounds and ambiance that's in the parks. If like the first couple of hours in the morning or the last couple of hours in the evening, you know, block it off that the noise levels, you know, only to this decibel. And then they bring it up, you know, at these times. So they have quite like quieter mornings, I guess would be a good way of saying it, which I don't know. I like quiet in the morning, so I would be totally fine with that. I don't see how that would have the opposite effect.
It's quieter in the park anyway. So if you do lower it down, the average guest may not even notice.
Exactly. I was going to say, I don't think it wouldn't be like you couldn't hear it because I think it would fit well with the flow.
I so rarely go at the very, very beginning of the day. So I'm like, noted. I'll have to do another early day at some point. But one thing that I think would help, no matter what, even if Disneyland made no changes to the park, what I think is like priority almost is having detailed guides available that just disclose what is about to go on. So this goes back to like the cognitive preparation. So like, given that autistic people have vastly different needs, it's absolutely impossible to find a middle ground that accommodates all autistic people. It's not even, you know, you should still try and reduce sensory input when possible. But the thing we all need that's like universal is just to know what to expect. So that can tell me, avoid this area at this time. That could tell me, oh, here is a safe place for me to do this or that. Can just, you know, help me avoid specific things that I can't do and help me think and, you know, and help me see, oh, this show does have this and I actually like that type of thing, you know, whatever. Glitter falling from the sky, maybe. I don't know. I don't actually, but you know, I can see how an autistic person might love that. Want to go to that. So to just know what to help plan rather than doing the guessing game. I mean, I do it. I'm a pass holder, so I just know the park really well. But if I were a newcomer to the park, I would be freaking out, being like, is this show going to be safe? Like, will I be able to handle this ride? I don't know. Should I risk it on this one or should I risk it on the next one? Like, at least I know, all right, I can't handle this one today. I can handle this. Okay, I can't do these two in a row, but I can do this. Like, at least I know. So it's less bad, but all of those decisions and having to guess whether you're going to put yourself in danger or not. So that's why I think, like, overall, just detailed just clarity, communication, have detailed guide for this.
So a detailed guide would just be like, you know, Mickey the Magical Map. This includes loud noises, you know, lots of action on the stage, visual things. Yeah. There's, you know, confetti coming from the sky, you know, that kind of thing. Just kind of basically just explain what all the elements of mm-hmm. something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I would be even more specific than that. Like, not even just like, I would be at the, you know, here's the thing. An autistic person has to write this guy. It can't be written by anyone else because no one else would be able to discern like the difference between this kind of loud noise and that kind of loud noise. But we know internally with each other. Some people.
Well, Chrysanthi, I think this is an opportunity for you to write a guide and make a lot of money.
Right.
I was going to say, I think this sounds like it could benefit a lot of people, not just people that have autism, but just, you know, anybody that has any sort of maybe fears or anything like that, you know, then you know what you're getting into. I think that's great.
Yeah. Like, so if you go to the park, you can pick up like guides for that tell you which things are wheelchair accessible and things mm-hmm. like that. You can already mm-hmm. do that.
Right.
And I will say that there is a cognitive disability guide. There is such a thing that Disney has online.
Mm-hmm.
It's only online. They don't give it out at the park. And when I ask cast members to reiterate what, cause there's, you know, so many changes lately, I'm always like,
sure.
Find me where the base is for this, just if I need to take a break. And they usually don't really know. There's not readily information for this kind of thing. Also the guide it's a great start, and I'm better than most parks. So like we're talking like, you know, upper level of parks. Disneyland, you know, already is on the right track, but it could be a lot more detailed. And it kind of seems like maybe they didn't have a lot of autistic collaborators on that guide. But the assumption is that your parents will download the guide before your trip and make and have it for you. Because they don't assume that an autistic adult is going to go to City Hall and say, can I have the like autism guide for myself? They would have expected you to already, you know, have someone who planned for that.
That brings up a whole nother thing that's kind of interesting to me is like, why as a society do we assume that like this is just a child thing? Like that obviously like you just grow out of it. Like if you have autism as a child, you're probably going to have autism as an adult, right?
Yes.
So I don't know why we, you know, like if you're in a wheelchair as a child, you're going to be in a wheelchair as an adult. Like that doesn't change. Like, you know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. I don't know why people don't connect that in their brain. To realize that, like, yeah, if there's kids that have this, obviously adults are gonna have, you know, it's not one of those type of things that are like, oh, it only affects you until you're 18 and then it doesn't affect you anymore. Like
being autistic, like, is not a bad thing, but the way society frames it is like some terrible disease, and it's really not that at all. It's like cognitive. It's like differences in how you process input and the world. And it's just, you know, there are a lot of things that I love about being autistic, and it just treating it like, I mean, just, it's all just ridiculous. The public perception of it, like the moves to cure it and everything. And it's like, you know, when I mentioned the amount of steps that it takes to do something and how hard it is mm-hmm. to do something, instead of like, let's cure autism. How about more of like, oh, let's ask if why, you know, if there's something they need rather than assuming that they're mad at me. Like, why not just have other people increase their communication? Like, it's always like autistic people don't know how to communicate with everyone else. But it's also like,
we need to learn how to communicate too.
Maybe, Like, maybe what, like, so what if like I'm not verbal at this moment? Maybe there's, you should learn how to read other parts of my body language.
And, right.
You know, because we're, as much as Disneyland and other places in the public accommodate autistic people, I guarantee we are accommodating the rest of the world so much more with every, like, every minute is like, all right, I won't make a big deal of it. All right, I'm just going to try this.
Right. Well, you bring up a good point that I did want to ask about earlier, and I just keep forgetting because you bring up so many great points that I just keep trailing off. What can others do? What could other guests at the resort do to make a day better for people with autism?
I would say be patient and, you know, kind of just normal human being thing. Just like be open, don't be patient, be, you know, I'm on this, some Disneyland Facebook group for pass holders. And, you know, there was some meme going around where it's like, this is how I feel when there's someone slow in front of me. And I'm like, things like that are very ableist.
Yeah.
It would be respecting personal space as well. I mean, it's hard.
I could tell you with the space thing, I had an issue with that this weekend. So here in La Crosse, we had a beer, wine, and cheese fest that we went to. We were waiting in line to get in, and these girls behind, like, I like to leave a little room between people. Yeah. These girls behind us, first of all, I think they were already drinking quite a bit, but they were being loud and obnoxious, which bothers me anyway. But they were, like, on top of us. Like, I could not move an inch backwards without touching them. And I don't have, as far as I understand, for myself, I've never been diagnosed with autism or anything, but that bugs me, you know. Right. It's like, give people space. Like, when I'm in a line and a queue for something, I give a little bit of extra space because
just be courteous.
You know, we're all going to get there at the same time. The fact that I leave, you know, an extra person space between me and the person in front of me is not going to make my wait any longer. You know, it's just going to be nice because, like, maybe if I want to stretch my leg out or something, like I get a cramp or something, or I want to bend over, I want to put my backpack down and get something out. Like, I've got that room. But when people are, like, on you, it's very uncomfortable. It's very claustrophobic feeling. It's like, can you just get... and it's, this happens at Disneyland to me a lot with kids, because kids, a lot of times, younger kids, they get excited with overstimulation of Disneyland.
Which is another reason Toontown needs to stay. But anyway.
Right. Yes. And you know, so they're getting excited and they're bored in a line or whatever. And so they end up, you know, climbing on the banisters and everything else. And they aren't aware of their surroundings very well. And so, like, they'll end up, like, bumping into you or... I always say, like, an accidental trying to, like, cut in front of you, but they're not really, they're just being kids and they're not aware that, like, oh, I'm getting in past your space, you know? So that's the stuff that bothers me. It's like, you know, can your kid just stop crawling on everything? Can your kid stop bumping into me? Can your, you know, but I get it. Like, it's boring as a small child, you know, and there's so much overstimulation that, you know, that's what they're trying to do to cope with it. How, you know, how they know. And so I need to have some patience with that too.
it's like a never ending dance of, like, radical empathy and just open mindedness. So, like, for example, if someone's crawling on a banister, like, to one person, super annoying. To another person, maybe it's like, maybe they have a cognitive disability and maybe they are, you know, this, maybe there's, like, another reason or whatever. Right. So it also, that's another way guests can just, you know, guests just be nicer and not, like, make fun of people and, you know, not point things out. But what you were mentioning, your experience of waiting, of being like claustrophobic, Tay, that's an example. That's a great example of something that you can't predict will happen, but may happen and may ruin the experience of waiting in a line. So if everything goes according to plan, I feel settled with the schedule of the day. Again, I'm a pass holder, so I can be more relaxed. But if I weren't a pass holder, this would be different. I would need to be on a schedule and, like, all this stuff. But for me, it's okay if I have to miss a ride. If I felt all safe with that, if I was, you know, having, if my spoons were high that day, if no one was going to touch me, if no, there weren't going to be any noises, like screams coming out of nowhere, if there were no bubbles are like a big random trigger for me. like those bubble gums just kill me. I loathe being touched by bubbles. And I was in a line once and the bubble gun started in front of me. Devastating. Something like that can ruin the experience of waiting in a line. So how do you describe to a cast member? So sometimes I can do a line and sometimes I can't. So I need this service because sometimes I can't. But then when I can't do it, it might lead to... that's the end of my day. My day has just cut short.
Well, and then you got to think about this too. You know, what if you have this pass, right? And you go, because it's not, you don't just go and get on the attraction.
No.
You have to go and wait in a different line, right? Or get a return time or something. But I've seen those lines before because I will admit there was a time when I was younger that I abused the pass program and all of my friends, we would just go in the exits and get on all the attractions and stuff.
Shame on you,
sir. I know, it's terrible. I look back and it was an awful thing. But
he's changed.
Yes. But I can tell you that, like, sometimes those lines are not too much better than the regular line. So what happens for someone like yourself? What happens if there's a kid there with a bubble gun? Like, even the pass doesn't protect you from that, really.
Exactly. Nothing. If the pass is really, I think people, when people think about how unfair it might be for someone like me to have the pass, they're coming at that from a very, like, neurotypical angle of someone who doesn't have these issues. So to them, it's like, oh, all the things that I do with that pass. But then for someone like me, I really don't do that much with that pass. Like, sure, I don't go on. I don't think I go on any more rides than like anyone else. In fact, if I could really game this, if I really were going to game the system and make sure that I'm always like double booked with like all, whatever, maxing out all my fast passes and let me just like see how many things I can go on. Like, I wish I had the energy to do that. I don't. So it's like, it's not even a big thing. Like, the people who have the passes are probably not really the people who are going to be draining all the park resources and lines in the first place.
Right.
Because, you know, I might have a limited number. Like, I actually can't go on Space Mountain, Guardian. I can't go on Guardians, and I can't go on Incredicoasters. I used to be able to go on the old roller coaster, but for some reason, the new whatever isn't going on with the thing. I can't. I have a really bad reaction right now. So,
well, there's more stimulation. It's not just the roller coaster. There's, you know, exactly. Jack running around everything else.
Lights and all that.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So, you know, which is great for some reasons and not in others. Like, I don't expect Disneyland to change that ride for me. I just know that it's not a thing that I can do. So I can't do that. I can't go on Space Mountain and Star Tours in the same 6-hour time. Like, I can't even go on all the e-ticket rides, like, at the same time, like, on the same day, even. I have to, like, if I go on an e-ticket ride that's, like, a kind of a fast one or, like, a roller coaster or something, mm-hmm. it's going to be hours until my next one.
Wow.
So I'm going to go on easy stuff in between anyway. So, yeah, it's not like I'm trying to use the pass to go on Space Mountain and then Star Tours and then Radiator and roller coaster and then Guardians.
Skip all of the lines.
I think you just proved one of your points too. You were saying earlier that it'd be nice to have a guide that explained what you were about to experience. Well, perhaps you would have known that before, because I assume that you rode the Incredicoaster and probably had a miserable experience.
Right. So it would have been nice to know ahead of time what you were getting into.
Oh, they've changed this since the last time I was on it. And because it's fundamentally it's the same attraction, but they've added things that are not good for you. So it would have been nice for you to read a description and go, okay, this has changed in a way that it's not going to work for me.
And that's another thing. Like, we don't necessarily as autistic people want to shield ourselves from everything, which is why I get very annoyed. Well, if you're autistic and you're having so much trouble, why are you going to Disneyland in the first place?
Everybody wants to experience it.
Mm-hmm. We do want to try to experience things and push our limits just like anyone else does. And so I did go on it willingly. I went on it and was like, and I actually went on it twice, not in a row, completely different days, because I knew I really wanted to just personally experience it with my brother. That was important for me. So I made an exception to go on it one more day, one more time with him. And I told him, like, you know, and he knows afterward, you know, you have this pep talk that I do with friends after this, I'm going to go on this. And I'm just letting you know, I already know that I'm going to get sick on it. I already know, like, and I'll still go on it. I'm going to get sick on it. And then afterward, I won't be able to do much. And then afterward, I'm not gonna be able to talk for 5 minutes. Like, I tell them this all before the ride, knowing that it's going to happen.
Sure.
I'm going to be not walking straight, but don't worry about me. I'm going to be okay. I'm just going to need like 5 minutes to go to the bathroom. It's going to be fine. But, you know, I just want to let you know now so that you're not like, what's wrong? Like, did I say something? Or like, do I need to do anything? Because that'll just make it worse. So,
yeah. You know, do we need to take you to first aid? You're walking, you're not rocking right. Yeah.
Right. Whatever. Where I just need to be like, all right, I'm going to go on this and I know what I'm getting myself into, but I'm going to pay the price for it. And on this day, I'm willing to pay that. Most days, maybe not, but for an exception, sure, I would want to go on that ride with my brother, etc.
Now, earlier you used a term, the spoon term. Can you kind of, you were going to cover that, but I think we kind of went past it.
Yeah. So spoons is a thing that comes up in the community, and it's anyone, probably anyone listening to this who's like disabled or chronically ill or something, will know this fully because it's how we talk to each other within the communities. Basically, spoons are an analogy for units of energy and like cognitive juice as well. So say I start the day with like, I have 10 spoons today. Okay. I can use one of my spoons to pick a nice outfit and like go through, you know, the decisions for that. I can use another spoon to make myself lunch. Oh, my mom called and she had bad news. Oh, that drained 3 spoons.
Oh, wow.
Okay, now I'm going to spend 2 spoons on like going to work or something. Oh, I got into an accident. Like, you know, oh, I'm going to have a few spoons left to make myself dinner. And then like go to, and then maybe the last couple spoons on like going to, you know, my friend's house, going to a show or something. We have limited amounts of spoons on many days. And so you don't want to blow them all on. I'm telling a cast member this, I'm going to have to blow a spoon on this, because then what happens is it gets to 2 p.m., for example, and there's been too many unexpected things that came up that you haven't budgeted for in your like spoon budget, and you're out. You're just out early. You don't have any more left. So you're done. You're done for the day. No more cooking dinner. No more this. You're out. You're out. So some days, you know, like for me, if it's a warm day, if there's great weather, then I will probably have more spoons that day, or if I'm not in pain or there's not already, you know, all these things happening. But when these things add on to the load, it drains the spoon levels. So yeah, how we talk to each other and, I'm going to go to this thing. If I have spoons left, I'll totally show up. Like we'll say stuff like that. Or like, hey, I'm running out of spoons. I even have like a button that I wear sometimes that just says I have no spoons left. Sometimes it'll be like, yeah, I'm up for it. Like I have a lot of spoons, like good way. Now, you know.
Well, hopefully this interview isn't taking too many spoons.
No. Sometimes you can get back spoons by, well, it's hard to say. Sometimes there are ways to get back spoons, like maybe taking a nap during the day or other sorts of things. Yeah. And sometimes even positive experiences drain spoons. I was going to say, like, this is probably giving me spoons in a way. At the same time, even when things are great, like for me going to Disneyland, there are many times I go to Disneyland where I have to have a full day of recovery. It's like the Disneyland hangover.
Right.
And it's not just Disneyland. It's like other things. It could be like, I just go to a networking event and then the next day I can't schedule anything.
Well, I feel that way sometimes where it's like, I am done. Like I am lucky. I have tomorrow off, but the last 2 days I've been really busy. So I feel like tomorrow is going to be my recuperation day. So on some level, I get what you're saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And yeah, that's the thing. Like everything I'm talking about, to an extent, everyone can relate to.
Yeah.
Which is a double-edged sword, which is great because then there's some grounds for understanding, but then you get situations where it's like, but I think things are loud too, and I don't make a big deal. And it's like,
right.
Everything is magnified.
Yeah. Well, it's all about our own personal perception of things and how we take things in. Just because how I take something in does not mean that's how Tag's going to take it in. That doesn't mean that's how you're going to take it in. So yeah, people just need to be aware.
And I think that happens a lot.
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
This is a good analogy. This is a good way to think about sound, for example, or sensory things. If you imagine you're in a room and you hear like me talking to you, you might hear that as the mix, just the general mix of like, this is what's happening in the room as you're talking to me. What an autistic person might feel, or someone who just sensory processing disorder or like other things, hypersensitivity. What an autistic person might hear and what I hear is like, all right, you talking to me is one track. There's also a track for the refrigerator that goes off every 10 minutes. Mm. There's also a track for a car that just drove by. There's also a track for, I can hear some footsteps. There's also a track for, you know, my computer fan. There's also a track for this random buzz that's kind of like in my, it's like that weird stuff. There's also a Oh, okay. Literally just now. I just heard from really far away, I'm sure, like a beep from somewhere. So like all these tracks are just turned up like at the same time. They're all turned up at the same time with like almost equal. I hear them all at the same, and I'm processing them all. Often people are like, oh, it's so quiet and nice here. And I'm like, are you, what? It's not quiet.
You hear that?
It's, yeah. Like it's not quiet. There's so much going on. Now I will say that not hearing all of those things at once is not always bad. Like it's not always bad to hear wind and this and that, or like, you know, if I'm listening to a meditation track or something, it might not be bad that I can hear all the different. It is a lot to process, but it's not necessarily bad noises that are happening. It's not a bad experience often. I mean, also I've been trying to meditate, so I'm trying to just be more like, oh, I'm noticing this. It's a cloud floating by or whatever. But this is a reason that Disneyland is so uniquely important to me as opposed to other theme parks, because the things that they do, like, you know, there's the good and the bad. I'm a musician. Like I'm like an expert at picking up sounds, and I use that in my work. It makes me notice so much more. Like there is a vast difference in the way that Disney mixes their sound and their sonic experience in the park than other parks. So we'll have to talk about that another time, but I noticed it and it is a vast difference.
So I do have a question. So I have very limited experience with the disability pass that Disneyland does have. I think it was before they revamped and did all the changes. We went and my grandmother was in a wheelchair. And so that was the experience I had. I think I was in like middle school quite a while ago. So when you have this pass, how does that work for you when you're in like a group? So say you're at the parks with your friends. Do you have to go through an extra step on those days to be able to have your friends come with you? Or is that kind of an easier process versus when you're first having to get the pass and having to go through the steps of this is why you need it and, you know, that whole process?
Adding people on is much easier.
Is it?
You just ask a cast member to link their accounts. I think you get up to like 5. It's like a total.
Oh, so it's all electronic now too.
Yeah. And also theoretically you could do it with the pass. So like the last person I went to the park was my mom. And the time before that was my friend, Justin. Because Justin is the person I've been to the park with 4 times this year, I only had to put him on the pass once because he's remained linked to my account.
Oh, okay.
This whole time. And then when my mom came, I had to, you know, I removed Justin and put my mom on instead. The app doesn't always work doing this, but having a cast member do it works just fine. so yeah, then I don't have to, there's no extra step. I can be the one that's just like, all right, I'm ready to put in my next wait time. And then they just do it to my card and it works for everyone's card. As long as we all go together and my card is scanned first.
Well, that's an easy process.
Yeah.
And then the other question I had for you is there, you know, we were talking about the spoons. So you kind of talked about some attractions that take away from your spoons, or they're, you know, just ones they just can't do. Are there any attractions or any places there that kind of help refresh you?
It's a great question. I find that generally speaking, California Adventure is more spacious. Sometimes it just helps to go there. Like on Christmas, I always go on Christmas. It's like our tradition. Mm-hmm. Disneyland was packed, especially Fantasyland, and California Adventure was ghost town. So that's one thing. And my biggest spot in California Adventure where I just like to sit for a long time is the animation room, where just all the things are playing. Mm-hmm. It's just very pleasant to get immersed in there. Now it does get crowded in there, so that's not always great. But another place is just far away from whatever parade is happening. And Pirates of the Caribbean. That ride is like when I need a break, if I need a sensory, that's where I want to be. It's on Pirates. Even it's a small world. Like, you know, some of the longer dark rides are helpful. It's a small world, Pirates. And
Haunted?
Yeah.
Haunted. The Haunted Mansion.
Oh God, especially Haunted, because like you are in Kirk. You don't really talk to people on that.
That's true. You are very isolated in that one, aren't you?
Oh yeah. That's a good one. Yeah. Uh-huh. But I think for as good as well thought out as their access pass is, I'm actually shocked that Disneyland doesn't do much more in terms of shows, because that is an area in which I would actually like more help in, is like Universal Studios does it, where like with my pass, I get to enter the theater before everyone else, pick a seat first. And I'm actually surprised that Disneyland doesn't do that.
That is interesting. So I feel like that'd be a pretty easy fix. You know, how big of a deal is it to let some people in 5 minutes before?
Well, so many other things do that. I mean, like, you know, if you go to ride on an airplane, if there's anybody that has special accommodations, they get let in first. Like, it's, people are used to it. So it's not like the people are going to riot because Disney's letting, you know, a handful of people in first to get, you know, where somewhere that they're going to be able to sit and be comfortable or whatever. Because some people maybe feel comfortable. They want to sit right up in front and like get the full thing. And some people maybe need to sit all the way in the back and just kind of be separated from it a little bit. So I don't know. To me, like, I think that, why wouldn't you allow people to do that? But sometimes when you look at these things, you know, and they seem so simple, but maybe there's some complicated reason behind it, or maybe it takes more staff or planning, or maybe the real answer is maybe they just haven't thought about it.
That could be.
Yeah, because I don't think any of these things that they do that I perceive as negative, I don't think any of them are intentionally bad. I don't think any of them come from a bad, this is with the public too. I don't think any of them are like, I'm going to be rude today. I'm going to be inaccessible today. It's literally just, unless you really talk to people who it affects, you just don't have that. You just don't, you wouldn't be able to see it because you don't notice it. It doesn't affect you. It's, you know, it's impossible. It would be impossible for someone who's not autistic to think and provide for me exactly how I would need to be. I wouldn't expect them to notice all the same things. That's like the whole point. We're different. That's like the whole point of it. But once you know, then like you kind of got to do something.
We're going to swing back around to the questions that we didn't get to. So the first one, I'm really excited to actually hear your answer on this one. So the, one thing that we always ask everybody is kind of, what's your Disney story? What got you interested in Disneyland or Disney or the parks, or kind of what got you to where you are now, where we're here on this podcast talking about Disneyland?
So I grew up down the street from the park. I was born in Hawaii and we moved to Southern California when I was pretty young. We mostly lived a straight shot down from Disneyland, right down Ball Road. Then you turn right to Atlanta Drive. You're there. Very, very close.
Wow.
Very
lucky. It was like her back.
Before that, I was even closer before then, like in Garden Grove. But anyway, my dad also had, I don't know what exactly it was, but through his work, he would have conferences somewhere next to Disneyland. I don't know if it was at Anaheim Convention Center or at one of the hotels or something, but every now and then we'd go down there. He'd go to his conference and they'd give all the families Disneyland tickets. So wow. I got to go through my dad's work. Like I'd go to whatever, some work brunch in the morning for the families. And then like everyone would go to Disneyland. So I got to go to that. Like
I could tell from your tone of voice that was definitely not the highlight of your day.
The work brunches.
The work brunches. Yeah. Like, I got to go to the work brunch. And then I got to go to Disneyland.
Although I love a good buffet.
I love free food.
But I also got to go for free a bunch of times as a musician growing up,
which
was super cool. They have a program that they still have called Magic Music Days, I think. It's basically where young groups of people can submit video auditions. And then if you get past the screening, you get to perform at Carnation Plaza or the Hollywood Backlot stage. And then after the performance is done, free park admission. So those are like my best middle school memories, are like when we'd get to have a day off from school because our orchestra would get on a bus and go to Disneyland, then get the rest of the day without our parents.
That sounds like the best field trip ever.
Honestly, the first time we got to do that was sixth grade, rainy day, like a bunch of 11, I don't know how, 11, 12 year olds in the park just for free, like no lines. I went on Indiana Jones 3 times in a row.
Oh my gosh.
It was like not credit at all. Not credit at all.
Well, you know, and I think people overlook the fact that, like, it would just be so cool and, in my mind, be such an honor to be able to perform at Disneyland.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it was super cool, super cool. And so that's how I got my start. My first annual pass was in high school. So I remember going after school a couple times. Then I went to college and then went to grad school. And I went to an art institute called California Institute of the Arts, which hilariously is Walt Disney's his final legacy. It was his final legacy before he died.
Oh, very cool.
Yep. He said on our school website, it proudly says a quote from him, "Cal Arts is the principal thing I hope to leave when I leave to greener pastures. If I can help provide a place to develop the talent of the future, I think I will have accomplished something." So basically, I go to Disney school. Disney had talent for my school. John Lasseter was my commencement speaker, the Pixar person. John Lasseter and Pete Docter, who started Pixar.
Wow.
Went to Cal Arts. They met at Cal Arts.
Yeah.
Tim Burton and Henry Selick, Cal Arts.
Oh my gosh. Wow.
Pee Wee Herman, Cal Arts. Like it's there's a lot of Disney entertainment people associated with Cal Arts.
Cal Arts is very well known. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, as I mentioned, I'm also from Hawaii, which is hilarious because Aulani is down the street from where our house is.
Look at you. You're just surrounded by the Disney properties, aren't you?
I can't escape it.
It's meant to
die
be.
Hard.
But do you want to?
I'm very happy about it all. and I've been to Disney World once, but it was a very unusual. One could say it was a non-traditional experience.
A non-traditional experience. There sounds like there's a good story behind that one.
We'll have to talk about that one next time. I'm interested to hear about it, but I also don't want to have like a 2-3 hour
long episode. Oh, nobody's going to complain about a long episode.
I do, and I have to edit the whole thing.
All right, so next question. So when you enter, first day you're in the parks, or if you're only doing the one day trip, do you have a certain way that you go? So do you enter the park and go towards Adventureland, Fantasyland, Tomorrowland? What's kind of your normal plan of attack or your normal route?
Depends on what time of day it is, if I'm hungry, and if my disability access service is still active. So often my first place will be City Hall. Or Chamber of Commerce because of that reason.
Sure.
Because of having to check on my pass or add people to my pass. If I go to the park and I'm hungry and I'm ready to like get my snack for the day, I go straight to Royal Street Veranda, the place you always forget about.
It's going to be burned in our memories.
It's good, though.
And I buy a bread bowl, just an empty, plain bread bowl.
Oh.
And I put it in my gallon Ziploc bag that I mentioned I bring. It with my pass, it costs $2 flat to get a plain bread bowl from there.
Oh, wow.
So that is a Disney tip, is don't buy the packaged boudin loaves for like $10.
Right.
Go to Royal Street Veranda. And as long as you don't mind if it has if it's pre-cut with the chunk at the top, then it's $2.
I'm like, you get the free labor.
it's actually so much better, because then you get if you've ever had a bread bowl, the top and the bottom are totally different. You get it's totally different experiences. And for a sensory seeking person like me, it's like eating both sides is a great pleasure. So I get that pretty much every time. That's where
I love bread bowls. I love bread bowls. I'm with you.
So I love sourdough, and Boudin's best sourdough, not La Brea. La Brea's are different. So that's where I go. If it's warm, the first thing I go on is Splash Mountain.
So what is your favorite attraction?
I think objectively the best attraction in Disneyland, if I could only take one person, one visitor on one ride, it would be Indiana Jones.
I like this answer. Indiana Jones is definitely a soft spot in my heart.
I just think it hits all of the marks. If I could have a smattering of my 3 or 5 to just give someone a sneak peek into Disney Resort, it would be Indiana Jones, Radiator Springs Racers, Haunted Mansion. I think Splash Mountain is what I was thinking. And then, or maybe it was Pirates. Something that gives you a sense of like a dark ride, a thrill ride. And then honestly, I think just Indiana Jones is just like a perfect, I think it's like perfect.
I get what you're saying. It's a great blend because it's like a thrilling dark ride.
It's artistically at such high execution. Also, Alice in Wonderland, I think that ride, I think it's like a masterclass media art.
I like that attraction. Producer James has an interesting opinion about this one. Yeah, Alice, because he thinks that, like my favorite part of that attraction is when you get to go outside on the vine. Like, it's just such a unique thing.
With controversial. I like it, too, though.
Yeah. But, like, James doesn't like it because he says, like, it takes him out of the story.
Oh, I see both sides on that.
Yeah, because, like, you're inside the world of Alice, and then you come out, and you're suddenly in Disneyland again, and then you go back into the world of Alice for another last scene.
Yeah, but I see you're still in the world of Alice because you're still riding the caterpillar, and you're on the vine. So.
But if you come out and, like, the parade's it's going by or something, it's
immersive.
Like,
immersive, I get that. Yeah.
But the reason I like it, I think it's awesome.
I think it's awesome, and also the reason I like it is the story of Alice is fundamentally one of being two different brain states. Like a dream and real life. So I think it's like perfect symbolism.
Oh, for like going outside because you've got the dream world inside.
Because you're like, wait, I'm immersed in this like Alice world. And you're like, oh, wait, what is this like other side of reality? And you're like, oh, it's like you're Alice.
Well, and then you're in Disneyland, which is a whole nother reality. So it's not even really reality.
It's super meta. It's just, it's great.
If you were to work at Disneyland, where would you work or what would you do and why? And this could be anything.
Something detail oriented and creative, like to help envision things. Like, you know, we were talking in the Discord chat about Toontown and I will go to town on like suggestions and optimizing things and going, seeing them through to like an artistic end of like all of the little details and all of that kind of thing. I think immediately if I were on a job tomorrow, I think it would be to collaborate with other artistic people and be a person who helps like make sure they're write this guide, make sure that there are guides for park goers. And like, I would love to be someone who kind of helps share my love for the parks in a way that makes them more accessible and can welcome more people in and have men know that Disney is providing them/us. I would love to do that. And there are lots of YouTube and Instagram, Disney fan disabled influencers who would love to do it as well, I'm sure.
What I don't understand, you bring up a good point, and you kind of got to the point, as I was thinking about it, which was, there's the Disney Moms panel.
I was just going to say, that's hilarious.
That is made up of, mom bloggers or whatever, that Disney, they're sanctioned by Disney to like give feedback and do a bunch of stuff for the company. Right. Why don't they have, like some type of group for people with different abilities?
Need to. They absolutely need to.
Perfect.
Well, and like you said, people that are in these positions are the people who need to kind of be putting the input in. Cause Teresa and I, when we had that episode, months ago, we tried to guesstimate things that might work, but our conversation with you, I think is really shown us how little we know about it. And we have okay ideas, but there's so much more that you can do other than this. So.
And it's okay that you don't know because there's no way you would know.
Well, and that's why we had you on the show. We want other people to know and be aware of it.
Yeah.
And not that everybody's going to be an expert now, but at least they can be aware of it.
Yes.
Right. So now you might think your awareness is a little bit more open. Next time you see something, you can think like, oh, with this, maybe this will, but then you're not going to notice everything. Even if you notice like 5% more, 10% more, that's progress. And I wish everyone would do that.
Well, I hope our listeners take that away, because even if everybody does, 1% or 2% more that listen to this show, I mean, that's a lot of percentages increased awareness by a group of people. So,
yeah.
Well, Chrysanthi, we really appreciate you being on the show. For those of you listening to the show, we do plan to have Chrysanthi back on. There's a couple other topics that I think she has some great ideas on. We want to talk, obviously, we kind of covered it a little bit where you talked about like the sound design of Disney, which I think would be a fascinating conversation. Yes,
definitely going to go more in depth with that one.
Yeah. Masterful. Yes.
And then the other thing that we are going to chat about is getting some more tips from you about different food options and what your thoughts are on that, because you're a vegan, correct?
Yep.
So kind of
long-time vegan and was even vegetarian. My entire Disney experience is
so you've got vegetarian. Both. You've got stuff from both lenses then. So even better.
And just to give a teaser, the vegan, they're astounding. They're leading the whole world. I think they won, like they were named best theme park, like best theme park for vegans, like
wow.
whatever. They have, like they actually now in 2019, they're great for vegan food.
Oh, that's awesome.
Absolutely wonderful. Like I can't tell you how much better than other it is at Disneyland for being a
vegan. I'm even more excited about this conversation yes. now.
Why? Do you want to go vegan? Is that?
No, just not necessarily that, but I'm 100% open to doing, trying different dishes. It doesn't always have to be
That's
the
true.
Same old. So I'm just yes. open
and,
to.
And they're really, really good stuff.
Well, Chrysanthi, if people want to follow you online, if people want to check out what you're doing, check out the music that you're producing or some of the art and stuff that you do, where can people find you online?
Well, as long as you know how to spell my name, which I don't know, I'm the only Chrysanthi Tan find. So basically, if you just look for at Chrysanthi Tan on Spotify, Apple Music, I have music on all the channels that people normally do, YouTube, you can always find me there. I even have a Patreon, but obviously, you have to know my music first to even consider that. So, yeah, check out my YouTube channel, my Spotify, my social media. I am a person of the internet. So, at Chrysanthi Tan.
I love that.
For the record, for those of you who are like, oh gosh, it's Chrysanthi, and then Tan, Tan.
Correct.
The spelling can trip people up, but then, of course, pronouncing it. So.
I'll also say that you can, if you watch the TV show Glee, not that you know what I look like, but yes, that is me in season 4.
And I'm gonna have to rewatch it. You're in Glee.
Oh yeah. You know how they have,
that's so cool.
You know how they have musicians.
Yeah.
I was like, so season four of Glee.
Very cool.
What episode?
Like 12 of them. Like, I don't know.
I was going to say, it's like they use like the same band all season, basically.
I am going to go look this up.
Best way to kind of describe it.
But you know how it is. You film all day. Very cool. You get like 2 seconds, but whatever. It's still fun.
But still, very cool.
Well, Chrysanthi, thank you for spending some time with us tonight. And hopefully our listeners will get something out of this. And maybe you'll notice a difference in the parks, hopefully. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Did you know that you can rate and review DL Weekly on iTunes every 6 months? If you haven't reviewed us recently, please do so, as it helps get our ranking better and allows the community to grow.
Well, did you enjoy listening to this episode of DL Weekly? You could support the show for as little as 25 cents an episode. If you want access to the supporter chat that we always talk about, it's only 75 cents an episode.
Well, now it's time to return to James over in Trivia Land to get the answers to this week's trivia.
All right, let's see how we did. Our first question this week, what state did the petrified tree come from?
And I think I said Arizona.
I said Washington.
And I said California.
Well, you're all in the right area of the states, but it was actually Colorado.
Wow.
Colorado.
Wow. I would have thought. Okay. Well, clearly I didn't think that.
So.
Me either. I mean, obviously, none of us did.
Yeah.
Arizona, the closest one there. So, second question. When did the Nightmare Before Christmas holiday overlay start at the Haunted Mansion?
I said 2001.
I said 2000.
And I said 1998.
And Tag's on the board with a point. 2001.
Ooh. Good job, Tag.
I knew that it was.
Also September? Was it like around the same time as September 11th?
Yeah, I think they soft launched it at the end of September, but it opened fully October 5th.
Oh, wow. So it was much shorter than it is now.
Yeah.
That's really surprising that it was the same year. But wow, okay.
Well, if you think about it, they probably had it planned and everything way in advance.
No, I know.
Yeah. Okay. Interesting.
Cool.
All right. Third question from listener Eric J. What is the name of the mining town location in which Big Thunder Mountain resides?
And I think all of us went with Rainbow Ridge.
Mm-hmm. You all got that one right.
Oh, good. Our mine train did not crash.
Everybody's on the board.
The power of your mind meld is pretty
strong.
A little
nod to the old attraction.
Of course.
That's nice.
Yeah. That's a cute little town. I know that a couple years ago, it was really falling into disrepair, and I know that they did some refurbishment and stuff on it to make it back to its former glory, which is always appreciated.
All right, our fourth and last question of this week.
I know Chrysanthi's very excited about this answer.
Yep.
Yes, from Katie J. Star Tours can be a different experience every time you ride it. How many different ride variations does it have?
I went crazy and said 1,200.
I think I said 180.
Oh, and I said 64.
And this number actually changed since Katie submitted this question. That's how long I've kind of sat on it. So it's now 384 variations.
So yes. How does the math work on that?
So there's 18 segments in total. There's 4 opening segments, 4 primary destinations, 6 hologram messages, and then 4 ending destinations.
Mind blown.
I knew that they had to be slotted in different positions. But is it still Galaxy's Edge?
I have to imagine that's how it's ending now, but I'm not there to know that for sure.
Because I would highly doubt if there's it's like every time I go on it, it's the same one now.
I mean, it makes sense. You want to build up the hype for Batu, so.
Well, you know what it is? It is the fact
right.
that Chris
but Anthony, I want to know if the answer is not. What I'm trying right. to say is if the answer is actually one, then I get a point.
Oh. I think we give her a bonus point for it because she's probably likely correct.
I think we need someone to prove it wrong otherwise. So, well, thanks to Katie and Eric again for submitting trivia this week. I love asking your questions, so send them to me and we can stump tag Teresa and the guests that join us as well. My email is trivia@dlweekly.net.
We will be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
So until then, go out and enjoy the parks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.